Peace, peace, boxing world. It's the King Legendary Top Cat. Hey, you can choose, lose, stay confused. You want some cool boxing news? Click that subscribe button. Hey, show the King some love. Like, comment, and share. I really put some time and effort in making sure I can provide y'all with some quality content. So we gonna do it like this here. I wanna introduce the new Sankofa boxing. Sankofa is a West African word, means to go back and get it. So in order to know where you're going, you have to know where you come from. We're gonna go back in the past, revisit some of the ancestors who laid the ground and made it possible for us to enjoy this sport of boxing today. We're gonna call it Sankofa tribe, man. Hey, y'all stay tuned. We got something real special coming for y'all. Peace. History was made. Join us as we give peace and respect to the old master. Charlie Burley. You know, people ask me who was the best fighter I ever met. And I tell them Rocky Marciano, because that's what they want to hear. Marciano beat me when I was 42, and I gave him a great battle. Eddie Booker and Charlie Burley were the best. They beat me in my prime. Shit. Booker broke my ribs. And Burley gave me a boxing lesson. He was something to see. He was a master at slipping punches. Counter punching. He walked to you with a good jab, fainted, made you miss. He was right on top of you. Either hand. Punching. America, 1920s and 30s, post-war. Prohibition and the Great Depression brought forth an economic drought in the country. September the 4th, 1929, Black Tuesday. The stock market crashed by design, which led to a secret meeting off the coast of Georgia called Jekyll Island, where the birth of the Federal Reserve Bank and America's future would be shaped and molded for centuries to come. Blacks in America were self-sustained outside of the economical system. Segregation resulted into group economics, forcing the black dollar to circulate in the community. While America was in a recession, black towns were flourishing. Harlem, Durham, North Carolina, Third Ward of Houston, Darling Street, Tulsa, Oklahoma, black Wall Street. It was fucked up in them days. When you're back against the wall, I mean, sometimes you have to rob Peter to pay Paul. You had to hustle. Shit. Running numbers, loan sharking, gambling, extortion, enforcer. Yeah. You see, if you had a little something from the shoulders, didn't mind getting your hands dirty. Well, that also put food on the table, too. You know. And a 12-year-old kid from Decima, Pennsylvania would walk into his destiny as he entered K Boys Club Boxing Gym on 2038 Bedford Avenue in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, where he moved to after the early passing of his father. They will settle in with his oldest sister and her husband in a black community called The Hill, founded by ex-runaway slaves in the 1800s. His name was Charlie Berkeley. At 16, he would win junior golden gloves at lightweight. Later, he would skip out of the Olympics because of his personal beliefs on racism in Hitler's Germany. Charlie campaigned for world champion at the welterweight division. Win after win couldn't win him a shot. Boxing and his politics robbed one of the greatest boxers of his legacy. Orthodox. Master boxer puncher. Godfather to the shoulder roll defense. Made fighters and promoters duck burly. Nobody wanted smoke. Word around the town was crystal clear. Don't fuck with Charlie Berkeley. That's a bad motherfucker. Charlie Berkeley wouldn't be the only field fighter of his day. He would be accompanied by 10 other black fighters. And they would become known to the world as the Black Murderers Row. Blackballed by the game they loved and fought for. These motherfuckers was so good, so feared, they were forced to fight a tournament against each other. Charlie Berkeley's record was 17 fights in the Black Murderers Row. 11 wins, 6 losses, 1 draw, 3 coming by knockout. He would hang up the gloves on July the 7th, 1950, finishing with a record of 83 wins, 50 KOs, 12 losses, 2 draws. He was never stopped. Shut out of history and the minds of boxing fans to come. He would never get his chance to be world champion. Peace and respect to one of the greatest that ever laced them up, Charlie Berkeley. That's peace, that's peace.
at me. I'm the best fighter you ever saw. Did you, Charlie Berry? Yes, Charlie Berry was an exception.
They still talk about you out in Minnesota.
Minnesota?
Yeah, when you was out there, they tell me you was out there knocking out heavyweights.
But the only thing, I'm so sorry they just wouldn't give me a chance to win at the title.
I want to thank y'all for coming through, giving me a little bit of your time. You can dig these blues, puzzle these clues. You can choose lose or you can stay confused. You want some cool boxing though? Click that subscribe button. Like, comment, and share. It's the King Legendary Typecast. And I'm out.
We've been told that the first people who occupied America, the Native Americans, came here across the Bering Strait. But what if someone told you that when the Native Americans came across the Bering Strait, there were people already living here?
Pre-Columbus America, covered in gold with kingdoms throughout the Atlantic, flourishing with established trade routes from North, South, Central Americas, the Caribbean Islands, and Africa. The heartbeat of civilization in North America was the Mississippi River. The ancient inhabitants of the area would become known as the Mound Builders. They built up and down the Mississippi River and southern coast of America. Their African phenotypical features would have them erased and replaced in history. Native Americans would be accredited their works. Many archaeologists and historians would argue the technology gap. Why? But the people with the science to build megalithic structures like pyramids and mounds find shelter in straw teepees. The Mississippi culture would migrate into East Texas to an area now called Alto, Texas, Cherokee Nation territory, where remnants of their ancient culture still stands. From the roots of the Alto, East Texas, rich soil, on November the 5th, 1917, Hilton Eddie Booker was born. He would become known to the world as Black Dynamite. His family would look west as they relocated to San Jose, California, where he would develop the sweet science of boxing. A highly achieved amateur with a promising career, in 1935, he turned pro at the age of 17. Managed by John Burdick, who would be criticized for his matchmaking with opponents for the 44-0 Eddie Booker. In 1939, he would step up in competition and take two back-to-back losses against Fritzy Zivic and Kid Coco. The taste of defeat did not sit well with his winning appetite. He would KO his next three opponents. In 1940, he would take some time off due to hand injuries, returning in 1941 with the KO. He would proceed to rise up the ranks by defeating Shorty and Big Boy Hogue, Bobby Burch, and Lloyd Marshall. He would go on to fight Archie Moore three times, two draws, one KO, becoming the first man to stop the Mongols. He set Archie down four times. The ref had to stop the match. Archie Moore would later say, "Eddie Booker broke my ribs." Thank you.
had some real fights in my time, Moore said. But all things being equal, when I was in my prime, shit. One of my toughest fights had to have been against Eddie Booker. A fighting machine who shot punches out with death, precision. Yeah. Booker was one of the greatest fighters of my time. He had me fighting for my life. Booker, with world champion dreams still in sight, he would follow the light. Booker would lose a 15-round war to the great Jack Chase. He would go on to defeat Harry Matthews and Frank Nelson. He would revenge the loss to the great Holman Williams. On March 6, 1944, with his short career, come to an end at the age of 26. Due to injuries in both hands and an eye injury caused in the match where the opponent gloves were laced. He fought most of his career without his hands and his eye being 100%, and he beat them all. He and the great Charlie Burley would never shut a ring, both saying, "That would be the toughest fight of my career." Eddie Booker, slick. Boxing puncher. With dynamite for a left hook. A defensive specialist. He would catch the opponent's punch mid-air and counter him. All in the same motion. Shout out of history and the minds of boxing fans to come. He would never get his shot to become world champion.
I've been so many places in my life and time. I've sung a lot of songs. I've made some bad ones. I've acted out my life in stages.
Peace, peace. To Black Dynamite, King Hilton, Eddie Booker, Black Murderers, Rowe. Peace, peace. I want to appreciate y'all for stopping through. Give me a little bit of your time. Hope you enjoyed the video. You can choose lose, or you can stay confused. Want some cool boxing new? Click that subscribe button. Like, comment, and share. It's the King Legendary Top Cat. And I'm out. One.
Baby, can't you see through me? 'Cause we're alone now, and I'm singing this song to you.
The European powers will look to dominate the oil flow in the Middle East.
The early years of the 20th century had added another reason for British concern about the Middle East. Oil.
While world bankers would look to dominate the currency flow in America by establishing a central bank outside the jurisdiction of the American government. The powers that be understood, in order to be successful, the world would have to go to war. And on 1917, America would enter World War I. Salvador Brazil, a U.S. naval vessel, the USS Cyclops, boarding 306 passengers and 10,800 tons of manganese. Destination, Baltimore, Maryland. As the ship sailed through the Bermuda Triangle, passage in the Atlantic between Florida, Puerto Rico, and Bermuda, aircraft and ships were said to vanish mysteriously. The USS Cyclops would join the phenomenon. All 306 passengers aboard would never be seen again. Amongst the crew on board was a Negro merchant marine named Lewis Hardwick, whom just relocated his family from Puerto Rico to Atlanta, Georgia, leaving behind a widowed wife, Maria Arroyo, and a four-year-old son. After the early passing of his mother, Maria, he would be taken in by his aunt, Antonia Arroyo Robinson, and her husband, Edward Robinson, whom at the age of 14 introduced him to boxing. And at 15, he would turn pro, May 27, 1929. His name was Herbert Lewis Hardwick, known to the world as Kid Coco. Gaining the respect of his peers with his skills, he would rise to the top of his game, big, tall, or small. He fought them all, from Lloyd Marshall, Jack Chase, Louis Kaplan, Burt Lytell, Lou Ambers, 8 wars with Holman Williams, Archie Moore, and the great Charlie Burley. Ranked number one contender for Hurricane Hank welterweight title would go unnoticed. The fight was never made. Kid Coco held the welterweight color title until being dethroned by Charlie Burley. He would later become middleweight color champion. The players in the game would change, but the politics would stay the same. His chances at a world title were slim. On November 24, 1944, Kid Coco would take on Oakland Billy Smith. It wasn't Kid's best performance. He was set down 4 times. The referee stopped the fight, fearing Kid was taking a dive. He was fined $500 and had his purse withheld. In 1949, Sugar Ray Robinson, Kid Coco, was set to face each other in the ring twice that year. Ray Robinson would later drop out both fights for whatever reasons. Instead, that same year, Ray Robinson would take on another challenger and call Kid Coco in to help with the sparring. Kid Coco would land a clean overhand right, flooring Ray Robinson. He would finish his career, 176 wins, 48 knockouts, 10 draws, 56 losses. Shut out of history and the minds of boxing fans to come. He would never get his chance to become world champion. Peace, peace, and respect. Kid Coco, Black Murderers Row. Peace, peace. I want to appreciate y'all for coming through. Give me a little bit of your time. You can dig these blues, puzzle these clues. You can choose, lose, or you can stay confused. You want some cool boxing news? Click that subscribe button. Like, comment, and share. It's the King Legendary Topcast. And I'm out. One. America exploded economically in the southern states. The British high demand for the resource cotton would draw the attention of settlers, entrepreneurs from all over looking to cash in. The industrialization of cotton would go hand in hand with the industrialization of slavery. Many of the black natives who occupied these lands before the settlers' arrival fell victim to the domestic slave trade. 1826. Vicente Guerrero would become the first black president of Mexico. In 1929, he would outlaw slavery. The decision would be bad for business and ultimately cost him his life. The settlers had a 1-year grace period to honor the new law of the land. Settlers were granted by law the right to settle in the eastern areas of West Texas, Coahuila, Tejas. One of the 19 constituent states founded under the United Mexican State. After Mexico won its independence from Spain, Coahuila was the poorest of the Mexican states, and that would prove to be instrumental in the revolt of the wealthy settlers, who would use their wealth to lobby for legalizing slavery. And when that didn't work, they turned to the gun. 1836, the Battle of the Alamo, which led to the Texas Revolution, where Mexico lost the land that would become Texas. The relationship between the British helped Southern America rise to power, even over the North. Aftermath, Civil War. 1924. From the ashes of the West Texas fields, on January the 24th, Calvin Coolidge Lytle was born. He would later become known to the world as Bert Lytle. 1942, San Antonio, Texas. A young man enlisted in the Naval Reserve. Opportunities in that day were limited for people of color. He would look to make the best of his journey, which would land him in New York City, where he discharged from service in 1944. The same year, he would lose his professional boxing debut against Artie Towns. He would fight out of the legendary Steelman's Gym. He would respond with 5 consecutive wins. He would fight 14 times that year and 21 the next. He campaigned at the middleweight division throughout the 40s and early 50s. His resume carries Hall of Fame names and respectable fighters of his day, from the likes of Henry Hall, the great Holman Williams, Kid Coco, Charlie Doc Williams, Charlie Burley, and the great Mongoose, Archie Moore. Highly regarded and respected by his peers, wouldn't be enough for the Chocolate Kid. Shut out of history and the minds of boxing fans to come, he would never get a shot to become world champion. Peace and respect to the great Bert Lytle. black, murderous, rope. Peace, peace. I want to appreciate everybody for coming through, giving me a little bit of your time. Hope you enjoyed the video. You can choose blue or you can stay confused. If you want some cool boxing news, click that subscribe button. Like, comment, and share. It's the King Legendary Top Cat. My one. Stay tuned. Up next on the Black Murderers Row series, Lord Marshall. This is going to be a good one.